Fran in the whatever this is. Yet another article in the paper that I've made videos about this topic before, but it keeps coming up in the news, especially since the pandemic, about hoarding. Hoarding! And I like I said, I've talked about this before, but now that I'm moving again, the volume of stuff that I keep on hand and maintain, and the expansion of my vault into Vault 2 and such, of course, it makes me think about the whole idea of hoarding. It says in this article here that hoarding disorder, which affects people of all genders and races, can begin as early as adolescence and typically increases in severity over the lifespan. The average age of a person seeking treatment for hoarding is 50. And it says that people who hoard see specific utility, someone might need that shovel, for instance, or sentimental attachment in objects that others would deem useless. Well, this very definition of hoarding means that I'm a hoarder, definitely. There's no question about it. But here's the real perspective, because it comes around in my comments whenever I complain about having so much stuff or having to move it. There will be the chain of comments. People say, well, Fran, clearly you have to part with things and it's time for you to throw this stuff out. I mean, do you even watch my channel? Do you even know what I do? No, there is, you know, an addendum that needs to be put on the topic of hoarding, which is, you know, what is the difference between hoarding and collecting? And what is the difference between a hoard of stuff and a museum collection? And the answer is pretty simple. The only difference between a pile of crap and a museum is curation. So, yeah, I do hoard because if you're a maker, if you make things, you have to hoard. It doesn't matter if you watch Adam Savage's channel, of his man cave, like filled to the literal ceiling with stuff, or if you're a woodworker, if you're a metal worker, if you're an electronics engineer, if you make stuff, you have to have lots and lots of materials and parts. And as I've discovered time and time again, painfully sometimes over my decades, is that very often when you make things, if you don't have the part, you're not gonna get it. And it's made me realize that even in my own, like, maybe not so carefully curated collection of junk, even amongst engineers, as I've learned through my comments of particularly young engineers who are surprised that the stuff that I present on my channel has ever even existed, I know that the majority of engineers out there, if they were to go through my vault, would either not know what much of it is, or pretty much deem all of it as to be crap, you know, and to be put in the dumpster. And it's one of the reasons I created the channel, to try to demonstrate the history and the value of these things that are not even that old. We're talking, you know, a couple decades forgotten about, like all traces removed from the earth of something that in my lifetime wasn't that long ago. You know, I've been posting films the past weeks, and people are surprised about the content of the films, especially people who, you know, didn't grow up when I grew up. And a lot of confusion in the, you know, wording and nomenclature in comments. A lot of people just don't understand what a film is or how it's projected, and the confusion of people who've only ever known video about exactly how motion picture works, or how do you synchronize with it, or how does this tape work? And people calling them tapes, that really frustrates me. It's the idea that there's a whole generation of people who've never touched or seen film and have no idea what film is, that there's a large chunk of the population that don't know what a camera looks like, a real camera. I'm not talking about a phone, but a real friggin' camera, as was noted in a post I put a couple weeks ago of this poor guy that got slammed to the tarmac and arrested for carrying a Hasselblad onto a plane. It's this kind of ignorance of history, even very recent history. We're not talking centuries ago. We're talking years, you know, two decades at most. Complete ignorance of stuff that existed even 20, 30 years ago. Careful, curated hoarding is essential to preserving history. And my channel is all about presenting that in, again, a curated form. I'm taking the mound of crap, unidentifiable, indiscernible crap that you see behind you and that's in the vaults and in the other shops. I'm trying to take all this crap and condense it into things that can be understood and presented to people who are astonished that this stuff ever existed. And that's sort of become my mission in life. but it's also sad and frustrating that I should have to tell people that this existed or this is how things were done when it just, in my own memory, I mean, I don't consider myself to be that old yet. I mean, I'm sure there are plenty of people watching here who think that I'm as old as dirt, but you know, I haven't been around that long comparatively, you know. But even in my reasonably decently long lifetime of half a century on the planet, so much of what I knew and was familiar with is gone, and I'm struggling so hard to just hold on to a few of the remaining things. That's really what, you know, Fran Lab has become, is just a pursuit of just trying to keep things in the world a little bit longer. In fact, case in point to the whole, you know, I call it the capstone to the hoarding thing, is that I recently wrote my will, my last will and testament, and I have no heirs, so my will is entirely generated around the idea that when I kick the bucket, that whatever resources Fran Lab has will be put to preserving the collection, you know, to keeping it in the world. And it's written in my will that there is to be no dumpster filling upon my demise, that certain things are to be given to certain organizations or, you know, certain groups, and the other stuff is to be, if possible, preserved as a collection, to be perhaps the kernel of a, you know, some kind of a technical museum or something that can be added to. And you see, that's the thing about it. All museums in the world, all museums began with hoarding, every single one. There is no museum on the planet that did not start, usually with a single person, hoarding something. And they hoarded obsessively throughout their life. They died, and miraculously their collection survived them and became a museum. And I'm not saying that my collection is that special, but there are certainly, and I have learned, that there are things in my collection that are exceedingly rare, if not one of a kind. And so I do think that my collection is certainly worthy to be the seed, the germ, if you will, of a museum, of some kind of a technological history museum. But it's in my will that you know, any overspillage after my demise of finances will go to a trust to maintain the collection, preserve it, present it, keep it in the world a little longer until those funds run out, and then it'll probably get put in the dumpster. But at least it gives a little bit of time for people to to decide if it's worthy. So in a sense, I have willed my estate to you, the viewers, because even after I'm gone, there is at least on paper a chance that Fran Lab would continue in some kind of a form, in some kind of a size. At least the creme de la creme of the collection could be kept in the world, and pretty much, like I said, whatever funds are still around when I kick the bucket will be put towards preserving the Fran Lab collection. So, all right. Well, thanks, everybody. Thanks, too, to all the patrons who, for reasons unbeknownst to me, continue to support this pile of crap. it is sort of astonishing. I am very thankful for the support that I get, but I'm equally confused and flummoxed because, you know, I'm often scratching my head about how much people do watch my content, and I'm kind of surprised. But hey, as long as it continues, we'll continue. So you're moving to a new space. I think you're gonna like the new digs. I've been spending a lot of time figuring out the new floor plan and everything too. I think that what you see on the channel will be presented much more coherently in the new space. It'll be shrinkified a little bit. You know, it's definitely less space, but it's going to be laid out in a way that will be more camera friendly, I think, and the lighting will be better, I think. So I'm trying to be optimistic about it. That you will like the new setup when we get there in 2022. And I'm very thankful that my patrons are hanging in there, being very patient. I have things to show you on the bench, but unfortunately I can't really get to the bench because I set up the main camera over there for the telecine, and until I get all these reels transferred, I can't really move that camera unless I want to go through the process of meticulously setting it up and aligning it again, which I do not. So anyway, we'll get to that when I'm done with the film. So anyway, enough of me rambling. Got stuff to do. All right. Bye!
Berserk in my lab, it's where I work. I'm Fran.